to four. Zipping up the victory.
Since you said goodbye to me, yes, I wrote my gal a letter, and this is what I had to say. Yes, I wrote my gal a letter, and this is what I had to say. Man, you know how I feel.
Come on in there, that's the Ravens from 1948, singing that Writing Me a Letter. That's one of the greatest songs ever put out. I love it. Ladies and gentlemen, we want to welcome you today to MPLStudio13.com, beautiful Millington, Tennessee. Y'all just come on in, sit back, and relax. I happen to have a real treat for you today, a dear friend of mine I've known all my life, Mr. Dennis Wages. He's a local businessman from a fine Christian family, knew his mom and daddy real well. And you're in for, a real interesting, influential. You're going to learn something today. So sit back, relax. Call all your friends if you got any. If you ain't got none, call somebody, neighbor down there. Just go somewhere and get somebody. But welcome, Dennis. Appreciate you coming today.
Griff, it's always fun to be with you. As you said, our families go way back in the history of Millington. I remember your dad and your mama and your sister and the fun times that I would have as a city boy, going out in the country and spending the day at the Griffin's house. And I learned a lot of things I could talk about and learned some things I can't talk about at the Griffin place. But it was always a pleasure. You were always a year or two older and wiser, and so I followed your career in basketball at Bolton High School and at Union University. If I remember correctly, I think one year Union beat Memphis State University in a basketball game, if I remember correctly, a long time ago. But you were probably one of the first local heroes to go on beyond the high school level, didn't do well in college sports, and later on at Goodyear in a semi-pro league. So you were always pretty much a hero of mine, and our friendship has been great. Your family is a dear friend of ours, always has been.
I appreciate those kind thoughts there. Another thing, too, is Dennis been in real estate. Matter of fact, sold my last house, so you can't ask for anything any better than that. But Dennis, tell us a little bit about your family now. Have you we're going all the way to Tacoma, Washington. Got some friends out there in Sacramento, California, and people are picking up on this at MPLStudio13.com. So some of these people don't know where Millington, just where is Millington located, Dennis?
Well, we're basically at one time 12 miles north of Memphis until Memphis annexed Frazier. Then we got about 6 or 7 miles closer. Millington was always a rural area dominated by large landowners, farms. The powder plant came to us during the World War II era when they tried to build powder plants in Europe. And, of course, the enemy bombed the plants, and so they built the powder plant out in Millington in a kind of a remote area in order to keep it away from the radar scopes in case we ever got attacked in America. It wouldn't be in the heart of Memphis. But it was the beginning of the you might call the industrial revolution of Millington, Tennessee. At one time it was probably the largest employer in the state, and many people came here out of North Mississippi, Southeast Arkansas, and their heritages and families, or many of them still remain here. My people came up out of North Mississippi. From my best recollections, when you went to the draft board in any area within a couple of hundred miles of here and you were denied access into the military for various reasons, they would recommend you go to Millington to work at Chickasaw Ordnance Works. And my dad had a hernia the government wasn't prepared to take him in the military and spend money on getting him fixed. So it was recommended that he and the Walls brothers, who owned all the Exxon stations in Memphis, L.C. Jackson, Otis Griffin, and various others, ended up here living in somewhat in times in chicken coops that people had converted into sleeping quarters. The women would serve them two or three meals a day. The men worked at the powder plant, and this is how so many people got here and stayed here. And then as the war wound down, the demand for powder wasn't as great as it was, and the DuPont plant started to unwind, and then they started building the base up at about the same time because of the logistics of the base. We were always told that it was built inland for fear if we were ever attacked, we'd be attacked on the shores, and so this would be a inland naval air station without ships. But yet it was really never an air station in that they never did pilot training here. But so many men and women end up working on the base, stayed here, because there wasn't much future on a sharecrop farm back in Mississippi.
Okay, I'd tell you folks out there, and then also in Murfreesboro, I've got my dear friends over there, Johnny and May Wilson in Murfreesboro, that they're already punching in. And so that'll give you an idea of what's gone on here in the past. Now, Dennis, you want to tell us about your family? I know you got a real sweet wife. And tell the folks that don't know anything about you what kind of family you got.
Otis, I have my wife is Dolores. Her and I were schoolmates in Millington. Two sons, Dennis Jr. and Jeff. Four grandkids and a brother that I'm very proud of is the city attorney and the city judge in Millington to this day. We were living in Millington when I was born. I have lived my entire life in Millington, Tennessee, and I was thinking the other day, I've never worked a day in my life that I did not work within the city limits of Millington, Tennessee.
Is that right?
First job was on the base selling newspapers. I've sold something all my life, yeah. But Millington is where I started, and I've had some opportunities over the years to take jobs in other areas, and I thought, you know, I can't work outside my shell, so I started here. I'm going to end it here.
Well, I didn't realize that. I know you were in Millington when your daddy was over at Mr. Woodrow's at Hey Dad's, and then down that road right there in that old White House. Whatever that was, I don't even know what's there now, First Tennessee Bank or something.
We were living on, we lived out off of Powder Plant Road on Rankin Branch when I was born.
Was that right?
And we moved into town when I was about two or three and lived on Cole Drive, which is today the street that you would go down to get to the nursing home, okay. Wesley Nursing Home. And in the late 40s, Ham Mitchell built a drugstore on the street where it entered into Easley, and then we became Cole Alley, and we lived on Cole Alley until we eventually moved up to Harold Street. In fact, when we moved to Harold Street, Babe and Ann Howard were our neighbors next door. So it was the nicer neighborhood of Millington, and it's still a viable neighborhood today. But all of Millington was... We never had a square. Millington's one of the unique southern towns that didn't have a square. And we had Easley Street and we had Navy Road, and those are the two major thoroughfares and still are the major shopping areas of Millington, you know, with the exception of the development of the highway.
Well, so I did not know that you'd never worked out of the city limits.
Not a day.
That's really amazing to me.
Not a day.
So you made all your money as you were working in the... In Millington.
I made a living in Millington. Millington never had an economy that you could, it was based upon a military payroll. And in the eyes of the world, the military payroll was basically always much lower than a civilian payroll, and that the government supplied so much of the needs of the young military families. And for the 40-something-odd years that we were a training command, all of our people were basically below the poverty level on nationwide figures. But it was the largest payroll in the state, and it provided many jobs, civil service jobs, as your dad was referred to by my dad as Griff. And that's the reason today I call you Griff, because that was the name that stuck with it for years. But it provided an income, some insurance, and then most people had a side job. My dad worked for Lewis Haydad on Saturdays selling appliances, and that's where he got his start. My dad didn't have a lot of education, but had a lot of personality.
Yeah.
And in the selling world, to be successful, you got to sell yourself first. And people trusted him and believed him. And our family heritage was based around a selling job. Lewis eventually opened up a furniture store. My daddy got in the furniture business and eventually grew into where we were in the furniture business for years and years and years.
All right. We're going to, they're just talking about a little money. Well, we're going to play something here from Elvis. I think he'll recognize we're going to go back in time here. See what.
You know, the landlord rang my front door bell. I let it ring for a long, long spell. I went to the window, I peered through the blind, and I asked him to tell me what was on his mind. He said, money, honey.
That's what Dennis knows, money, honey.
What you want with me? I said, money, honey. Money, honey. Money, honey. If you want to get along with me.
I don't care who you are, that's good. Money, honey. So we're coming to you from MPL Studio 13.com. And one thing I want to tell you is, in case some of you hadn't heard, Brian Miller's a library director down there, and he's doing everything he can to get the talent. We have a lot of talent around this part of the country, whether you sing or whether you dance or whether you're an artist or ballet or whatever you happen to be. All you got to do is give Brian a call at 872-1585. Make an appointment, call him, and he'll have you in. We can help you a little bit, see if we can get you a little publicity, because I know it's hard to get on TV. And if you, we have some great singers, and there's a boy named Kojak that was around in Millington probably 30, 40 years ago, and there's been other garage bands and different places, so you never know what you're going to run into. But it's MPL studio13.com. ladies and gentlemen, right now we have a treat going on, talking to Mr. Dennis Wages. Been around here, and one thing is very significant, that he's been in Millington city limits making a living, and I might say a good one. Now, he'll tell you he's about to starve to death, but I know better than that, because I've seen him eat two or three bologna sandwiches at one time. But Dennis, you've always been involved. Now, I know your daddy was, I believe they called him alderman in Millington, isn't that right?
Yeah, Millington traditionally had a strong mayor form of government with an alderman. positions. I got involved in the, my dad was always involved in civic endeavors, and in order to make a community a reliable and enjoyable place to live, everybody had to participate in some type of activity. Just wasn't making money and providing for your family. You're also concerned about the neighbors and your neighborhoods and so on and so forth. So at one time, Millington had several active civic groups, and I became a JC when I was not really quite old enough, but I got involved in the Junior Chamber of Commerce because I was in business with my dad. And I really enjoyed the community work. I really enjoyed seeing the community change and involve, and through my JC experience, as well as other friends that I made then or today were involved in politics and Shelby County level and so on and so forth. So when I was 20, in 1968, I was 26 years old, I believe, I ran for the board and was elected, and I served 32 years on the city council. I had one term that I did not run after my dad was killed. I had to get more involved in the family business. I had a young brother in school, a mother to support. So I took a sabbatical for one term, then went back and served until I retired. When George Harville retired, I retired as an alderman from the city of Millington.
How many aldermen did you have?
There's seven aldermen, and
it's always been that same.
Yeah, and until this last year, the city changed its management form to a city manager form, and the first city manager is in the process of being interviewed, hired, and come January we will swear in a new mayor, but it will be a city manager form of government. Charter's been changed. Much of the power would be directed now, and influence of management of government would be transferred to the city manager and the mayor as a basically a part-time mayor to be assisting in the change.
Now, did I understand you correctly? For all the folks that are out there in say Miami, we got friends there, and we also have some Deb and Steve that are in Wisconsin. Did you say that you served as alderman for 36 years?
32 years.
32? Mm-hmm. Is that a record or close to it?
Well, I don't, you know, I've not ever researched it, but I don't recall anybody ever serving that long as an alderman, though.
Yeah. Well, but, it's especially around here, but I know the sheriff over there, Brother Kelly over in Fayette County, mm-hmm. he the longest serving sheriff in the state of Tennessee.
Yeah. So.
But, what other clubs? I know you've been. What is it, Chamber? You helped me with this. What community clubs have you been involved in, Dennis?
At one time or another in my career or my years, I was a member of the Optimist Club one time when Jimmy Whitlock was pretty much very much involved in Millington, and I was with the Lions Club for several years. I was a member of the Chamber of Commerce, in Millington. If you did not have a family business in Millington and you grew up there and went away to school, when you came back, there wasn't a lot of opportunities. Keep in mind that the history of Millington before the naval base and before Chickasaw Iron Works was a rural area, and the powers to be weren't always in favor of industry because it would raise the price of a tractor driver to the point that the farmer did not want to pay that. And they were influential landowners throughout northern part of Shelby County that had a heavy hand in controlling the destiny of a community. And of course, farmers did not want industry, and it's understandable why. But for a community to grow, you had to be able to offer something for your young people to come back to. And so, unfortunately, Millington did not have, unless you had a family and business, a lot of opportunities for a young man to come back and support his family. And so you were here, you had to pay your role, and you had to do, you know, your share and fill some shoes from others who didn't come back and take over those tasks. So.
Well, one of the things that's always been of interest now, you got to understand Daddy having to know some of the older ones, was like Mr. Babe Howard's daddy, mm-hmm. and of course there was Clarence Rowland, which is not much older, wasn't much older, he's passed away, but all the people that knew What do you attribute all the growth from Millington to back when, say, you were a kid, Dennis, and the growth that you got going on now? What do you think?
We always struggled to develop residential growth, and we also struggled with commercial growth because the Navy, and I'm not complaining per se, but whatever you had off base that was successful, the Navy would duplicate it on base, many times not realizing how a negative effect it would have on the local economy. We had a theater in Millington, the Strand Theater, and it was very successful. Then the Navy built the theater, and of course you have to understand, with 12,000 young sailors who were potentially available to come to the theater in Millington, if they could go to the one on base for half price, and quite naturally they'd go to the base theaters. The Navy had several restaurants on the base. It was very difficult for a man to open a restaurant in Millington and compete with the Navy. My dad at one time had a very successful go-kart track, and you'd pay for a chance to drive the go-kart around the track. Well, it wasn't long that the Navy opened a go-kart track on the base, not trying to be competitive, but being able to offer that same thing for the young sailor. And many of these programs, or most of them, were driven by MWR, which was Morale, Welfare, and Recreation, which was a non-funded part of the military. It was non-appropriated funds. Curtis Person, in about 58, opened, at that time, was the world's largest, most modern Brunswick bowling alley, with underground ball return, overhead scorekeeping, a beautiful sight. Well, immediately it became the number one revenue-producing Brunswick bowling lane in America. In a few years, the Navy opened a bowling alley on the base. In a few years, Mr. Person's bowling alley closed. So it was always difficult to compete with them. Now, we did not complain. It was a patriotic thing to do to support your military. They supported our economy, but yet they competed with our economy. So we had struggles over the years doing that. The naval base had service stations, grocery stores, commissaries. Anything that you had off base, they had on base. Housing, the military provided housing for their military officers. FHA, it took for years and years before FHA would approve a loan for a home in Millington because of what had happened up in Milan when they closed that military base in Milan. It put a world of hurt on that community, and the FHA took it on the chin with foreclosures and so on and so forth. So it was a long time, because the naval base in Millington was never considered a permanent base until the late 50s, early 60s. It was always considered a temporary base. So it was hard to get financing. So the Navy was a great thing for Millington in some aspects, and in some aspects it was a little bit of a negative. And so we never experienced the growth that Germantown possibly did and others because of the military presence.
Well, tell somebody that's maybe young, it's happens to be listening, where was this, things have changed, but where was this bowling alley located, Mr. Person?
The building is still there. It's the Cash America Pawn Shop on Highway 51 North, and it's still a viable part of the economy. It's leased to various businesses, but that was the location of that bowling alley.
All right. Dennis, while I got you in a Lewis and Clark mood, where was the famous Watley's restaurant that everybody in this part of the world must have eaten at one time? Where was that located?
The original Watley's restaurant was located on the west side of Highway 51 North, along in an area about where Sonic is now, between Sonic and Ryan's. It was located over there on the west side of the highway. And she eventually moved to Navy Road, next door to the where it used to be Hodges Service Station on Navy Road. It was located there for years and years.
Okay, what about the, Curtis Person had his Chevrolet dealership right there at Navy
Road. Where U Holland is on the corner.
Okay, mm-hmm. And the telephone company.
Telephone company originally was on Easley Street in a location about where Buzzy Hoffman had the laundry room years ago. There's a car wash there now. But the phone company was located in a house right there when I was a child, a kid. That's where it was.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to take you back in time, folks. And they had an ice house. Now, where was that located, Dan?
The ice house was located under the water tank, which was located just behind where the car wash is today. And the Strand Theater, of course, is where it is today. And Hal Mitchell had a little service station there on the corner where Marlin has his Amoco station, his transmission shop today. And that was all of Millington until Navy Road began developing in the late 40s, early 50s.
Well, there's another one there that they had the Mays Howard Lumber Company out there on North 51.
Yeah, it was up on 51 about where... across from the ball field where Lenny's is today. Mays Howard had a lumber company there. It burned in the late 50s, early 60s. And just south of there on the east side of the road is where a coal lumber company started their operation, where Southern Meat is today.
Okay, and you... There's one that really stand out, Daddy. We went to him just like we go to Mr. Bodrice now. It's a Porter R. Puller drugstore. Where was that located?
The Porter drugstore, Puller drugstore, was on the highway at the corner of Cuban Millington, where the motel is today, and across the street was where the branch gin was, about where the bank is on that vacant corner there. And okay. The gin was there for years and years, and then Puller's was there.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're getting a lowdown on the history, and I hope in some way we're going to play you a little music here. Dennis said he hadn't heard a song here by, let's see if I can find it here. I'm going to have to back up one now. What we're going to do right now, we're going to play one. I'm not going to let you guess, but anyway, this is, see if you recognize this one right here. I know you heard it by a different artist, but it's going to take you back to the 20s for this one here. This is Big Mama Thornton. Yeah, I bet money very few of you ever heard this song. Mama Thornton, Hound Dog. Mama Thornton and Hound Dog. You might have been listening to Elvis. Well, how you like that there, Dennis?
You know, Otis, that song, that beat, that rhythm, that was what I grew up with in Millington. You know, we only thought there was one radio station, that was WHBQ. And when Dewey would come on for his hour show, it seemed like he would be on for 2 or 3 hours because that was the highlight of our day. And up until then, the only exposure to music we had had in Millington would have been Slim Rhodes in the back of a flatbed truck doing a grand opening somewhere. But to be able to get Dewey Phillips on the radio on HBQ was as the 13 or 14 year old boy in Millington, boy, that was exciting.
Well, I tell you, it was, and we got a treat here with Dennis, and he knows all about the one time they had the radio station that his dad was part of. But right now, I want to tell you, it's MPL Studio13.com coming to you from Millington, Tennessee. And we're privileged to have a dear friend and a mighty fine fellow, Mr. Dennis Wages, local businessman and a great representative of Millington, Tennessee, in here meeting with us today and talking to you. And we hope all you folks out there in Tacoma and Sacramento and Miami and Murfreesboro and up in Wisconsin, Jackson, Tennessee, are listening in. So right now, I've got a little surprise for you, and you may not know this, but I'm going to sit on him. And Dennis, you tell us about the time that your daddy had the radio station in Millington, Tennessee.
Well, it was really an exciting time for us because in that area, Memphis was becoming the hotbed of rockabilly with Billy Riley and Carl Perkins and Elvis and Johnny Cash and people like that. And so my dad and Curtis Person, Mr. Howard, Joe Matthews, I believe Morris Rainey, Earl Griffin, were all investors into a radio station. Of course, none of the men had any experience in that world, but they were wise enough to bring professional people in, and they did their research. And Millington did not have a daily newspaper. It was getting harder to compete with Memphis businesses. And so they felt like a radio station would give us some individuality, and it did. It gave us the opportunity to promote our businesses and our civic endeavors and our government on a local radio station. So they put their resources together and founded and applied for it through the FCC and were given a charter to operate a directional band radio station, daylight hours only, in the heart of downtown Millington on Navy Road. And the first studios, for my benefit, fortunately, were located in the retail center, and at that time we had a store in the retail center. And it started off in a little old bitty back office, and they had a control booth, and we could go stand at the window and look in there and watch a DJ. And although it was a very boring job probably for them, but for us to sit there and watch a guy turn records on and then look at us through the window when he was playing the record was pretty exciting, because over the years we had personalities like George Klein and Harlan Hill of the Chicago Bear fame was the sports director, and different personalities were coming and going in radio stations, so it was an exciting time for us.
Well, that's great. If I remember correctly, the call letters WGMM is on 1380
on your dial.
AM. Mm-hmm. So how long do you think that radio station lasted there?
Elvis, I can't remember exactly, but it seemed like it was there 4, 5, 6 years, and the popularity had expanded, and they needed more visibility, and it moved over into the plaza. And then the disc jockey was up in the showroom window, and they worked out of there. The station had grown to several employees, various announcers, sales force. They did a great job of promoting our community, bought radio spots. It was affordable because the men who owned it were more concerned about the exposure of our community than they were making the profit. So radio time was inexpensive, and it was a tremendous asset to our community.
Well, Mr. Hyder, was one of the...
Bill Hyder was one of the earlier disc jockeys, Chad Lasseter, Bill Thomas. You know, the list goes on and on. And all of those people had experienced radio success in other fields, and they all had friends. And it was not uncommon to see celebrities, in our eyes, coming in, going, visiting their friends at the radio station. And it was an exciting place to be around and go to.
Well, who is your number one disc jockey and your number one hero that ended, for a better word, his career in the...
Well, no doubt about it. When Dewey Phillips became available to be hired at the radio station, and the owners got together and agreed to hire him, Dewey was a phenomenon in the radio world, in that he single-handedly introduced Elvis to the world through the playing of one of his first recordings. And history tells us that Dewey played it over and over and over one night, to the point that Elvis himself was called and went to the radio station and very bashfully was interviewed on the radio. But Dewey knew music. He had grown up in the Memphis, West Tennessee area. He had worked at Crest in the radio shop. In fact, that's where he began the music career, selling records for, I think it was Crest or one of those five and dime stores. On Main Street. But Dewey brought with him a world of followers. He brought with him the expertise of the music world and connections that opened up a world to us that we had never experienced. And Dewey and I became close friends. I took several trips with Dewey. I visited with him in his home over the years, and he was a great guy to be around.
Yeah, that's one of the things that I've always stood by, that Sam Phillips got a lot of credit, and deservedly so. But if it wasn't for Dewey Phillips, we got the wrong Phillips, got the most of the credit. But as in my opinion, if it wasn't for Dewey Phillips, I spent a little time with him, several times visiting. I was just amazed and mesmerized. That was my hero, and I don't mind admitting it, because he knew music. He had rhythm and blues. He'd play country. He'd play rock and roll. He'd play anything. It was just good music. And so I guess that was one of the highlights. He put Millington on the map, and this was been back in the early 60s. And it was just great being able to talk to Dewey. But ladies and gentlemen, I got Mr. Dennis Wages here at SMPLStudio13.com coming to you today, and we're talking to Dennis. We're getting a history of Millington, been here all his life. Now, there's one thing that stood out in history that really is very, very interesting, and we're just going to touch base with it. It was Baker, Mr. Charles Baker. Would you expound on that just a little bit, Dennis?
Chairman Baker, or Charles Baker, was a very influential member, and in fact for years and years chairman of the county court. And due to the growth of the rural area of Shelby County, and of course Memphis's urban takeover of politics, Chairman Baker fought diligently for the little man, and to the point that he felt like the municipalities outside the city of Memphis were not getting fair representation in the control of county government. We have to remember history, in that Mr. Paul Barrett was one of the most successful bankers, planners in the county area, and had great influence in county government. And he wanted to see the communities of Millington and Brunswick and Arlington and those areas to be able to grow an equal quality to and size of the city of Memphis. But because of the rule of government that the big boy called all the shots, Mr. Baker was successful in bringing legislation about that was eventually appealed to the Supreme Court, and he won the case. And he went down in history as the man who originated in the theme and the idea of one man, one vote, and it was very successful. And because of that, the outlying communities of Shelby County were able to prosper and grow to the extent that today they represent a fair population of Shelby County.
Oh, that's amazing that You don't know where this happened, and you don't forget about it and in the history, but it comes down to Millington, Tennessee. It's a fine community. You got great people. You got great businesses, and all around, it's like so many of the people we have, just like Justin Timberlake, is from outside of Millington, Chevy Forest area, and you've had Elvis and visiting, and all different celebrities have been to Millington. But I'm gonna, I know this, and right now I want to tell you we're at MPLstudio13.com, and I want to have a little shout out for a good friend of mine, Chris, up there in the Louisville area, has hooked me up with this equipment. I use Crosley. He's been able to service. He picked out all this good stuff for me and been able to help me. So thank you, Chris. And all this Crosley equipment is top notch, and I appreciate it. And thank you very much. And I got a little $2 story I'm going to get this to spit out on you here. And it's kind of cute, and it's kind of interesting. And go for it there, Dennis.
Referring to the economical impact that the Navy had regarding the community of Millington. There were some concerns and doubts about the military were spending all of their money in the Memphis area, and so the government said, "Well, we'll show you what the impact is," and so they began paying with $2 bills, and of course, you know, at that time, $2 bills weren't very popular. People didn't carry them. You collected them, basically. Well, all of a sudden, they flooded the community with $2 bills, and the business people quickly realized how important the impact that the military payroll was in the community of Millington. And it was it got a lot of national attention, a lot of press that they were there, and they were meaningful. But another little interesting story, talking about people being discovered and the base's impact. And not many people younger than you and I will remember this, but there used to be a radio personality that was nationally known by the name of Arthur Godfrey. And he went around the nation and having amateur shows and entertaining basically the troops. Well, he was in Memphis one time, or at the Naval Base, with the Arthur Godfrey show, bringing talent on from local area, and there was a guy on the base named Julius LaRosa who sang on Arthur Godfrey's talent show at the base, and actually he was discovered and later became a national recording artist, and he was discovered on the base in Millington. And we all have been watching the Pawn Stars, and the old man was a Navy veteran. I'll assure you that he probably at one time was stationed in Millington, Tennessee. Here recently, I have a client that was telling me a story that she was on I believe it was the Price is Right show, and I might not be. I'll have to get this correct to get from her. But anyway, she was on that show, and she got selected as a contestant. And before the show went on air, they would met the MC, who was nationally known. And he said, "Where are you from?" And she said, "I'm from Memphis, Tennessee." He said, "I was stationed in the Navy back in the 60s in Millington, Tennessee. And here's a guy that's a national acclaim." So we don't have any way of knowing. And I hope maybe through your show, there's going to be people who pick this up and remember Millington that maybe at one time served here, and it may bring back some memories of their time in Millington, Tennessee. And with that many sailors coming and going, I'm sure there are many influential people throughout America that at one time lived in Millington.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have Mr. Dennis Wages, and these are the things he's experienced in his life at you know, newcomers, the younger kids out here and are not aware of, and you get your history lesson. But these are things that you'd sit around and talk about over a cup of coffee that you didn't realize went on in Millington and surrounding areas. But Dennis, there's been some Millington's moving ahead right now, and seems to be flourishing real well, even though the economy is not doing exactly great. But Tell us some of the best times that you can remember in Millington growing up and all during your lifetime.
Well, we were always somewhat removed from the city of Memphis, basically because of the Loosahatchee River bottom. When you left Memphis, you came through an area that was remote, and then they knew you were coming to Millington. And as a child, you know, sports programs, when the Millington Junior League Baseball was organized in the 50s under the direction of Edwin Ray, that was something that brought a tremendous amount of enjoyment to the community. And later we evolved from that program into at one time we were the national training site for the Olympic baseball movement. Mr. Howard was very influential in that venue, and of course the whole community was involved in it, and it gave us for a period there for about 6 or 8 years of housing some tremendous athletes that would come and spend the summer in Millington in their training preparations for the Pan Am or the World Games, and then every 4 years the Olympics. Alex Rodriguez spent a week or 10 days in Millington. Frank Thomas, who went on to great fame, spent a lot of time in Millington. The list goes on and on. In fact, in 1988, 14 first-round draft choices spent 6 or 8 weeks in Millington. Whole community got involved in host family programs. And because of their presence here, we had Maury Wills, we had Stan Musial, we had just numerous baseball Hall of Fame members that would come and spend time in Millington to be with the baseball program. We had the most outstanding coaches in college baseball come and coach our Olympic teams. And it was really a great time and a really an opportunity for the world to see what a small town could do with community support in supporting such a national program of such prominence.
Well, I think one of the things that, Dennis, it was so great, and I've heard so many people that are very proud that they would take the ball players as they came in, and they would put them up and house them and feed them and take them wherever they needed to go.
Yeah, it was a host family program. I was chairman of housing and meals, and I was able to get the team housed on the base, and I was the volunteer responsible for the feeding of the team. And, yeah, we had some great host families. In fact, I won't mention any names, but most of them created such a relationship that it went beyond the years in Millington. And a lady that's she's lives in Millington today, several years ago, her son, adopted son from the baseball team, called her and said, "I'm sending you a gift." She was not expecting what happened, but in a few days, a tractor-trailer truck arrived in the front of her house, and a brand-new Mercedes automobile was backed off the car and presented to her as a token of his appreciation for what she had done during his couple years in Millington. My host son 1 year was Frank Thomas, and he still owes me $5. So, Frank, if you're listening, I need my $5 back.
Yeah, well, I don't know whether he can afford it.
Right, but, you know, at those days, they were just kids. You know, and so they were away from home, and the host family program was a tremendous program, and most of those people are still around town, and we have great stories of our kids that were part of the USA baseball team.
I think one of the things that I didn't know just a few years ago, and you correct me, is Mr. Babe Howard was able to go over to Cuba.
Several times. Oh, yeah. He was very well accepted and very well liked in Cuba. Mr. Howard had a heart of gold, and there were so many stories that have never been told about his generosity to the foreign national teams who came here, because in his eyes, politics wasn't the thing. It was the help the people thing. And I'll never forget the first time the Cuban team came here. The poorest equipment, shoddy gloves, worn-out shoes, but great athletes. Very aggressive ball players, but when they were not on the ball field, the nicest people you'd want to be around. The first night they were here, they would shower at the stadium. and they were, I think, 22 or 26 on the roster. We put out, I think, 18 or 19 bars of soap. Next morning, all of it was gone. I said, Mr. Howard, we put out 18 to 24 bars of soap, and it was all gone. He said, put out twice as many the next night. We put out the next night twice as many. Next day, not a sliver of soap anywhere. We were eventually putting out a case of soap a day, and it was disappearing. Yeah. And soap was so hard to get in Cuba. Oh. Those guys were saving that soap and taking it home. And so it never made national, because that's just the way Mr. Howard was. If he were here today, he'd first time he'd tell that story. Yeah, he would give them, the last year they came, he gave them money to have something to do and something to take home with them. And they all went to Walmart and bought box fans.
Is that right?
Not buying their wife a gift or their girlfriend a gift, but a box fan for the family, because fans were hard to get in Cuba. So he was always very, very concerned about the welfare of those other undeveloped nations who sent their athletes here. And an athlete to him was an athlete. There's some tremendous stories of his generosity toward the baseball program.
Well, since you brought up Mr. Howard, one of my projects that I have in the future, and I've already gotten the okay from Holly, but I'm going to do a documentary, well, not by myself, but just like right now, the one person that Josh Coleman is our producer and our director, our editor, and he does everything. All I'm capable of doing is try to do a little bit of talking, but if it wasn't for Josh and Brian and all of my friends come on here, it's going to be on it. But I'm going to do a documentary on Mr. Howard. And by the way, the family is such a great story to be told, and told several people whenever I started doing this that it was just one thing, because Mr. Howard was so great a person that I'm sure that not everything has been told, but I just feel like it's the right thing to do. So that's one of my projects down the road, so y'all would bear with me. It'll probably take 6-8 months to do it, because there's so much to tell, but I'm going to do it.
I think it'd make a great it'd be the most interesting thing that so many people had knowledge of his existence, but so many people did not know the real Babe Howard. I think it'd make a great
gentlemen, we're talking to Mr. Dennis Wages. We're here at MPLstudio.com, and I'm going to play you a little song here that I discovered about 3 weeks ago, and I couldn't figure it out. And I thought, well, this is it's got to be Ruth Brown, Laverne Baker, or somebody. And so I started listening to it, and I said, man, that is great. I don't know if you can figure out who this is or not. Start off with a good beat. Everybody knows the name of that call, 872-1585. Twisting tongues, talking. tell you one thing. I like it. That's got a good beat, and that gal can sing. I never heard of before. It's Pat Benatar. I think she's come back in the early 80s. Didn't even know she recorded anything. It just happened to accidentally. I was fooled. I didn't know if that was Ruth Brown, Laverne Baker, Etta James, who was. I like it. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, right there, Pat Benatar, The Good Life. But I thought I knew my music, but I guess I ain't smart as I thought I was. Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking to Mr. Dennis Wade. He's on MPLstudio.13.com. And he's enlightening us with a little history going on in Millington, Tennessee. So I had to, we had the some good times here. What are some of the worst short times you have some of the worst moments you've had in Millington, Dennis?
Well, Griff, you know, personally and community-wide, I would think that the day that five of our town leaders perished in a plane crash in New Orleans was a really sad day for the community, because the men who were lost were leaders, business people. And when you take a small community and take out five of their of the strong leaders, it certainly has a devastating effect on the community. And that was a bad week or 10 days when you I'll never forget Tina Hamilton's article about the sorrow of burying the sons of the town. And that was a bad day personally and community-wide. It had an effect. It basically ended at that time what was a very viable sportsman's club that was a group of men who had like interest in hunting and fishing, and because of that accident and losing so many influential members, the club eventually disbanded and went away.
Well, tell everybody the heartache and what you suffered and how it hit you personally.
Well, there's no, you know, every father-son relationship is very close, and my dad and I were very close because he was a big man, and he could hit a golf ball further than anybody had ever known, and he could fish better than anybody had ever known, and shoot straighter than anybody I'd ever known, and people liked him, and he liked people, and so he was my hero, and when I lost him, of course, here I am. I don't have a big brother, and I don't have any uncles living here. And I had a mama who was a housewife, and that's what Daddy wanted her to be. He wanted her at home when we got out of school. And I had a brother in high school, or ninth grade. So it was a devastating loss to me, or as anybody would be. But, you know, a community pulls behind the people who need help, and the community came forth, and Curtis Person had a tremendous influence on my life from that time. Mr. Howard, I'll never forget one time I was having some issues financially and with business, and I said something to Babe about it, and he said, well, what's the problem? I said, well, my dad would really be upset if he knew things are going this way, and he said, no, if your dad was here, he wouldn't go one day past that. He would have gotten rid of that problem and started on something new. And it, you know, it clicked a lot. That's exactly what he would have done. So, you know, people step in and help. And I wasn't a child. I was 22, 23 years old. But the men of the community who knew that I was young and green were supportive. Your dad more than once, unbeknownst to you, said, hey, if you need something, you call me. And, you know, Griff was tight. But when it comes to helping somebody, I think if I'd have gone to your dad and said I needed $10,000, I'd have got $10,000. Now, he might have cried a tear, but he'd have given it. So, but that's what those days and times were about. And I think in today's society, I think us more mature people need to be more sensitive to the needs of young people, young business people, young fathers. You know, we've had the experiences, good and bad. And it's to our responsibility to continue the traits that our dads established for us. And so many times that doesn't happen But it should be. We should be more concerned about the future, not of our stock and our investments, but the future of our young people in this country.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know one thing I'm very proud of is Mr. Woodrow helped me immensely get through college. If it hadn't been for him, I don't mind admitting it, that I never would have graduated. But a lot of people don't know that when he got ready to go on this trip, I was working at Union City. We just had been transferred down to start the Goodyear plant. And so I was within about 2 hours or so. So Mr. Woodrow called me and he said, somebody canceled out on this trip. They're going to take go hunt wild animals. Well, I really didn't know anything about it, but he called me. But we're just getting started on that plant. So I couldn't get off work and take vacation. I think it was going to be gone like 5 days. I'm not really sure, but he called and I tried my best to get off, take that trip, which meant I'd be sitting here right now, but he thought enough of me and gave me the opportunity, and so I had for some reason or other it just didn't work out, and but I had the opportunity to go hunt some wild animals. The only wild animals I knew how to hunt was them rabbits and coons out there in the field behind the house. But well, ladies and gentlemen, we've been talking to Mr. Dennis Wages, and one of the worst times. You've had a couple of floods.
Had some floods that were devastating to the community, but here again, the community pulled together and put those areas back together. Took care of the people in the low-lying areas, and unfortunately, people who live in low-lying areas traditionally are people who hadn't been as successful in life and didn't get a house on the hill. And those areas were helped accordingly, and so we have survived it. The Corps of Engineers has come in over the years and put that Chickasaw Basin north of town and dredged some ditches, and so we've overcome that issue. The last time they had some devastating flooding on the base, we're still concerned about what might affect that might have, and the government expanding the base in any area, but. We've overcome those times, and I think the future for Millington is bright. We still have a lot of available land for development. We have more than an ample water supply. Sewer facilities are not anywhere near capacity. Many communities in the country are suffering with a shortage of sewer operations, water supply. We have ample supply of both. Shelby County has gone as far south as it can go. The river is always blocked among the west. Eastern part of Shelby County is fully developed to the Fayette County line. And the north part of Shelby County is still a very viable area. Quick access to downtown. Not every business has gone out east. So Millington's in a great position with great leadership and some good, solid citizens to still be a potential bright spot in Shelby County.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're talking to Mr. Dennis Wages. He's been what I like to refer to as a pillar of the community, along with Mayor Harville for so many years. Mr. Curtis Person, Babe Howard, the list goes on.
Tom Hall. We've had some great, great leaders in the community, and none of them were interested in the next step up the ladder. They were interested where they were at that time and what they could do for their community. And Bill Osteen, tremendous influence to so many kids over the years in the school system. And the list goes on and on. Paul Barrett, Charlie Baker, the list goes on and on of very influential people that really helped shape North Shelby County and Shelby County itself.
I think Daddy knew some more, Mr. Ham Mitchell and Mr. McNamara, and they were very influential. We're talking Dennis, and he's was and is one of the pillars of the community, member of the First Baptist Church for quite a few years.
It's the only church I've been to in my life.
Is that right? The only one. But, ladies and gentlemen, what we have now on MPL, Studio13.com, is we're offering a free, it doesn't cost anything. If you have some friends, they don't have to necessarily be kids, but if they're gifted, and there's no way to get anything out, whether it's art or whether it's singing, playing the saxophone, the piano, or anything that you do. I know you have a lot of kids that they won't. It's not a talent show, but you call 872-1585. The library director is Mr. Brian Miller, and he's done a great job trying to organize this thing. We've had some good people, Senator Mark Norris behind us helping us, Shelby County Mayor Mark Luttrell has been helping us, Dr. George Flynn, radio and the radiologist and so forth has been. This is not a 1-2-3-man show. Mr. Josh Coleman is going to all the trouble, and believe me, he's a genius trying to figure all this stuff out, how you do it. All I can do is just talk to these people. But it takes people like Dennis that keep the community rolling, so we owe a debt of gratitude. You're not going to find a better Christian man. Help people regardless of what you need. You go to him, and he'll help you. If he can't do it, he can find somebody that can. So,
Otis, if I might, you know, this show is going out. We don't know how far it's going to reach, but we don't know how many people it's going to reach. But I'll assure you, somewhere along the line, we're going to reach some people who had some experiences in Millington, in the Navy, baseball, whatever. And I would encourage them, if they've got something that would be interesting to add to the history of Millington or an experience they had here, it would be nice if they'd contact the local library and pass that antidote on to the man at the library. And he certainly would, you know, be welcoming that contact and bring some history back to us that left before the years. And I think it'd be interesting. I like old stuff, like you and I both. And it would be interesting to hear from some of those people who were here 30, 40 years ago and can remember some things they saw or did in Millington in the 30s, 40s, 50s. And I'd encourage them to get back with us and bring it up.
I think one of the things that already happened is some of the people that lived here, and they've moved off for whatever reason, relocated in different places, and even made contact. And they get a hold of this, and they've contacted their folks back home and said, guess what, you can hear this. So y'all punch in, kick in, get in, lay in, or whatever you can on MPLstudio13.com. Mr. Dennis Wages has been our guest today. I really appreciate you coming. And I think that some of the people out here that hadn't heard some of the history and everything, but y'all keep your ears open, and we welcome anything that you've got to present at 872-1585 over at the Millington Library. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to let you go on about your business right now. If we can wake up the Ravens, we're going to see if we can get anything out of them, and I guess we're going to call it a day. So if you boys get us out of here, Dennis, thank you very much for being with us. And
it's been a pleasure, Griff.
And thank you very much. And God bless each and every one of you. And y'all be safe now. So, all right. This is the Ravens. Let's go home now, boys.
Been myself since you said goodbye to me.
Email.
Yes, I wrote my gal a letter, and this is what I had to say. Yes, I wrote my gal a letter, and this is what I had to say.
All right, till the next time, ladies and gentlemen, we'll see y'all later. God bless you.
The four.
Organization.
Wrapping up the victory.